Welcome to part 3 of our series on security and encryption. Up to this point, we've covered the basic concepts of security and cryptography, and we've also covered how to secure transmissions going from one person to another. In part 3, we'll cover personal security, things you want to keep secure that you don't want anyone else having access to, like your files containing personal information such as financial data. Of course, one thing you can do that we've already covered is to encrypt them. We covered before how software like 7-Zip can strongly encrypt an archive of files using an encryption key derived from a password. The only difference here is you don't have to worry about how to securely give your password to anyone else because no one else needs it or should have it. You are the only one in possession of the means of decrypting the file. This is generally referred to as TNO encryption, which stands for Trust No One. With all of the other forms we've talked about until now, this wasn't an option. If nothing else, when Alice sends a private transmission to Bob, she has to trust Bob to keep it private. TNO encryption means that she doesn't have to trust anyone else. However, there's a trade-off. If Alice forgets the password she used to encrypt the file, or loses the piece of paper she wrote it down on, she loses all access to this information. But really, there are only two options here. Either you're in charge of your own security, or someone else is. Who else is there that you can trust? There are other issues as well. What happens if Alice needs to access an encrypted text file? It must be decrypted and opened in a text editor. But that text editor might save a temp file unencrypted on Alice's system. Even if the temp file is deleted when she closes the text editor, as we'll see later in part 3, a deleted file isn't gone and can be retrieved from her disk with the right software. This is a concept called leakage. No matter how good a job Alice does in protecting the encrypted file, using it can cause an unencrypted copy to be placed on her system. Another way this can happen is with something called a swap file. In order to avoid problems that can happen when a system runs low on memory, modern operating systems use what's called virtual memory to store parts of the computer's RAM in a file on the disk, which is called a swap file because its contents are swapped between this file and RAM as Alice opens different files and runs different apps. If the unencrypted text file in memory gets swapped to disk, then it's possible for the unencrypted data, or even just parts of it, to stick around on the disk long after the file is closed out. It's better to use software that is made specifically to encrypt files on a disk. One such application that's available for free is Veracrypt. Veracrypt is fairly new, but it's based on an older and well-trusted piece of software now out of development called TrueCrypt. With Veracrypt, Alice can create a file on her disk that ends in .hc and is full of what appears to be pseudo-random noise. Alice picks a strong password and tells Veracrypt what size the volume should be. Afterwards, she can mount this file as a virtual drive and access the files as normal. But if the file isn't mounted, then no one who doesn't know the password can access the decrypted data. However, this doesn't solve the problem of leakage. If the temp file is outside this virtual drive, we can have the same issue we discussed earlier, and we still have the issue of the swap file. So Veracrypt gives Alice options to encrypt a partition, and if that's the partition where her temp files are stored, then she'll be safe from leakage to those temp files. To protect herself from leakage to the swap file, she can encrypt the system partition. This locks down her entire system. No one can even boot into Windows unless they type in Alice's TrueCrypt password. Someone stealing her drives and examining them on a different system will find only pseudo-random noise, and as long as Alice has chosen a sufficiently secure password, they'll have no hope of decrypting it. One nice feature Veracrypt has that it inherited from TrueCrypt is plausible deniability. Alice has the option to create a hidden volume inside her Veracrypt volume secured with a different password. That way, if Alice is forced to give up her password, she gives them this plausible deniability password and the attackers get innocuous data. She can even use it on a system partition and have a completely different installation of the OS with completely different files and software installed. Veracrypt is distributed through an open source license, meaning the code is free for anyone to download and examine. It's also multi-platform, available on Windows, Mac, Linux, and many others. There are other options. Most modern operating systems have a way of encrypting the drive natively. With Microsoft, that's a feature called BitLocker, available in Ultimate and Enterprise editions of Vista and Windows 7, and Pro and Enterprise versions of Windows 8 and up. BitLocker can work transparently using a TPM chip, a Trusted Platform Module. Alice can purchase one of these inexpensive chips and put it on her computer's motherboard. The disadvantage of this method is that someone who steals her computer gets the chip, too. Veracrypt doesn't support TPMs for this very reason. So there are alternatives. Alice can use a password, or if the computer's BIOS can read USB devices before the OS boots up, she can use a USB key. There are disadvantages to BitLocker. The closed source nature of the software means that it cannot be verified that Microsoft hasn't and won't insert a backdoor at the insistence of the US government, although Microsoft insists that it'll never do so. It's also Windows only, meaning that any external drive secured with BitLocker can't be read on a computer running any other OS. Also, the removal of certain key features in recent versions caused concern among security experts. BitLocker, therefore, generally isn't recommended. Other OS-only encryption features include File Vault for Mac OS X and various solutions for different Linux and other Unix distributions. There is also another open-source fork of TrueCrypt called CipherShed, which is still in development as of this video's upload time. This is a good start toward securing your own personal data, but there are other issues to talk about. Future videos in Part 3 will cover securing cloud storage and issues associated with newer technologies such as solid-state drives.